Welcome to the Queen Anne's County Board of Education. May I have a motion to go into closed session?
As permitted by the Section 3-305B of the General Provisions Article of the Annotated Code of Maryland, I move to go into closed session to discuss a personnel matter that affects one or more specific individuals, to review human resource personnel report, to review several administrative items, a settlement agreement, in-category transfer letter, transportation contract extension, collective bargaining, OCR complaint regarding web accessibility, heroin signs at the high schools, minutes from March 1st and 16th, upcoming meetings and events, and to consult with counsel to obtain legal advice on a potential legal matter.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to go into closed session. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. We will be back at 6 p.m. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed say no. The ayes have it. And now we move on to special recognitions, and we'll turn it over to Mr. Poliski.
Okay. If you come and join me. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening.
Good evening.
Welcome. Tonight we'd like to express our appreciation and thanks for the efforts of our talented staff and our students of Queen Anne's County Public Schools. Tonight we have a special recognition of Mattapeak Elementary School Bookmark Award. The Maryland Judiciary Mediation and Conflict Resolution Office, MARCO, holds an annual Conflict Resolution Day bookmark art contest. Each year, MARCO observes Conflict Resolution Day by hosting a bookmark contest for students in kindergarten through eighth grade. This contest provides an opportunity to talk with students about important conflict resolution skills such as listening, working together to solve problems, talking instead of fighting, and appreciating differences between their peers. Mattapeak Elementary School has 5 students who received honorable mention for their artistic skills and creative ideas to relay their messages about conflict resolution. Would Evelyn Sweet, Ashley Hughes, Katie Stoltz, Ethan Bennett, and Austin McGuire please come forward along with their principal, Mrs. Jennifer Schreckengast. Hi, how are you? These students and their artwork have been recognized in Annapolis. Thank you for your creativity and hard work. Mattapeak Elementary School and the entire Board of Education are so proud of you. Ladies and gentlemen, would you join me in another round of applause for these artists? Would you like to come up and join us in a photograph very quickly?
Oh, God, I'm standing.
Okay. Perfect.
Yes, sir.
Oh, no, please. Please.
Oh, come on.
Go ahead, hide.
No.
You're more important.
One, two, three. Thank you.
Miss Hipsky. It was brought to my attention that Ms. Hipsky needs to be recognized as well because she encouraged these students, and it's my understanding that she drove their artwork or applications to Annapolis.
She went to great lengths to get us entered into the competition and worked with her husband to get those entries hand delivered. She drove them to the entry site.
Wow. Talk about above and beyond. Please stand and be recognized. Thank you. The next award is our Hero Award. The Queen Anne's County Public Schools Hero Award is sponsored by our friends at Six Flags Theme Park, including two complimentary tickets to Six Flags. The Hero Award is also sponsored by our Anti-Bullying Committee and Character Counts Committee. This month's Hero Award will be given to Denny Corsi from Kennard Elementary School. Would Denny please come forward and his family? Congratulations. Come on up. Dad's got them all. Here we go. Mrs. Heidi Rusum nominated Denny for this month's award. Denny is also a friend to everyone at Kennard. No matter what day it is or who is around, Mrs. Rimson recalls a time when everyone was outside at recess and Denny helped another student. This particular student had never played kickball and wanted to try it out. Denny was on the opposing team when the other student kicked the ball. Once the student kicked the ball, he was unsure of what to do next. While Denny's team was so quick to attempt to get the student out, Denny ran up to him and helped him run around the bases and gave the student a big high five while cheering him on. Denny is the true definition of a hero because he is always willing to help other people before he helps himself. Denny is always putting a smile on everyone's face, and we want to thank him for being such a great role model for the students at Kennard Elementary School as well as all of the students in Queen Anne's County Public Schools. Denny, thank you so much and congratulations. Yes.
Ms. Carey.
Mrs. Russum. Mrs. Russum, absolutely.
All righty. Are you ready? You say cheese? One, two, three. One more. One, two, three. Thank you.
Congratulations. Our next special recognition is our Black History Month Unsung Hero. Chesapeake College hosted a Black History Month luncheon in February. During this luncheon, they recognized local high school students as unsung heroes. Queen Anne's County has three unsung heroes recognized at this luncheon. Would Sydney Kay, Jazaria, I hope I said that right, Jazaria Blake?
Javaziera.
I apologize. From Queen Anne's County High School, would you please come forward? Wonderful. Jamira Warner was the unsung hero for Kent Island High School, but unfortunately could not attend this evening. These high school seniors and juniors were recognized at the Black History Month luncheon for their ability to make a difference in their school and their communities. These students are a positive influence for their peers, making their school and communities a better place, and are setting and meeting their goals. Thank you, ladies, for your positive attitude, your hard work, and for the positive differences that you make in your schools each and every day. The examples that you set for your peers is what makes our high school students so successful each and every year. Thank you. Hang on, let's get their parents or if they're guardians or anybody would like to come forward and be a part of it. Yes, wonderful. Lots of
lots to be proud of.
Come on.
Thank you.
Awesome. One, two, three. One, two, three. Thank you, everyone.
Our next special recognition, our Working Arts Forum First Ladies Art Gallery. Sydney Kay is a Churchill resident and graduating senior at Queen Anne's County High School. In the past year, Sydney's artwork has been entered into a variety of local, regional, and state judged art shows. In the spring of 2016, one of her pieces took third place at the Congressional Art Competition. At this year's Academy of the Arts student show, in which she had been a four-time exhibitor, Sydney received an honorable mention for her submission and was awarded second place among all high school students that participated last year. Due to her notable artistic achievements, Sydney was recently awarded a scholarship of $500 provided by the Working Arts Forum. Her artwork, entitled Hopeful Delaney, was also selected for exhibition at the Spring Student Artwork First Ladies Art Gallery, which was held at the Maryland House of Delegates Gallery Space in Annapolis. Following the state exhibit, this piece will be donated to the Queen Anne's County High School Media Center, where it will be a permanent display. Sydney intends to attend the Cleveland Institute of Art, where she will major in animation. Her future goal is to own her own animation company, and I have no doubt that you're going to accomplish that. Our next award, Queen Anne's County High School is referred to as the pride of the Eastern Shore, but Isaiah Dodd takes pride in being a Queen Anne's County Lion. Staff members and administration at Queen Anne's County High School took the time to let us know some of the ways that Isaiah makes a difference at their school. Isaiah, would you please come forward? Throughout the day, Isaiah goes about his routine, making sure that the teachers have what it is that they need for instruction. Whether it be sharpening pencils or replenishing the paper supply and the many copy machines throughout the building. One staff member shared, "Isaiah is the most trustworthy, dependable student that we have in this entire school." Each morning, Isaiah, on his own, gets the keys to the school store and checks that everything is ready to go for the day and reports what stock needs to be ordered. He assists the physical education department with their class pins, needed cleaning, and enjoys assisting the yearbook committee, all with a smile on his face because he cares so much about Queen Anne's County High School. A staff member shared that Isaiah has the uncanny ability to see situations before they occur and is there to help and make it better. He's the first one to step up, carrying equipment for unified strength training and setting up the bocce ball court. He encourages his teammates by helping them do better at any activity. The past 7 years, he has been a part of the Queen Anne's County High School basketball team. He makes sure that at timeouts, all the players are hydrated. He is ready at a moment's notice to rush on the court and assist the referee in wiping up after any player falls down. Many are unaware that after each basketball game, Isaiah takes the water bottles and towels home to clean them, making sure that they are ready for the next game. Isaiah is a devoted Queen Anne's County Lion fan over any other sports team around. He does it all with a smile on his face and a big heart. However, we think it's Queen Anne's County High School that should take pride in Isaiah. If we all had a little bit of Isaiah in us, we would realize that what a great school and community we are all part of. The staff at Queen Anne's County High School has a surprise for Isaiah. Would you please come forward, Mr. Kelly and staff?
I've asked a couple of our staff, Isaiah's coaches, and some of the players on the basketball team, because we all do appreciate what he does. Isaiah, I know you got team autism going, but at Queen Anne's County High School, I have the A team. As the athletic director, my A team is the team of teachers who help us run our events. They're the ticket salesmen, they're the monitors of the games, they help set up, and Isaiah is an honorary member of that A team. So to Isaiah, I want to present you with this shirt. Okay, this is yours. Wear that proud as you are a part of the A team, okay? Well done.
Queen Anne's County Public Schools Spirit Award goes to a staff member who is enthusiastic about their job and spreads spirit throughout their school every day. Mrs. Jeannie Necessary has nominated Mrs. Erin Holthaus, I hope I said that right, at Mattapique Elementary School as the Spirit Award winner. Would you please come forward? Would your principal please come forward? Mrs. Holthaus always has a positive attitude and is always offered to help her coworkers. She's an active member of the PBIS committee, loves to try new instructional strategies, and shares them with her colleagues. Always has a smile on her face. She constantly goes out of her way during her planning time to check in with her colleagues who may need a help or even a pep talk. Mrs. Necessary says that Mrs. Holthaus is a true asset to Mattapique Elementary School. On behalf of the Board of Education and Queen Anne's County Public Schools, I want to thank you for all that you do each and every day, and you exhibit all the great things that are wonderful about this school system. Thank you for all you do. Absolutely. Should be so proud of her. It's all good.
All righty. One, two, three. One more. One, two, three.
Sure. Do you know who it is?
Katie Stoltz.
Okay.
Queen Anne's County Public Schools Energizer Bunny Award is given to an employee who just keeps going. Their energy is endless and their hard work always shines through. This award is sponsored by our long-term partners, Chip Brittingham and Mr. Wayne Humphreys and Mr. Mark Humphreys at Bayview Financial. This month's Energizer Bunny, nominated again by Mrs. Jeannie Necessary, is Mr. Stephen Rafter. Would Mr. Rafter please come forward? How are you, sir?
Good, how are you?
Congratulations. Would his principal please come forward? Mattapique's making a queen sleep. Queen sweep tonight. Mr. Rafter is a huge helping hand at Mattapique Elementary School. He is one of the go-to people, according to Mrs. Necessary. He always jumps right in and helps without ever being asked. Mrs. Rafter takes the time to check in and see where he can help with some of the struggling students. He spends extra time organizing the STEM fair and reaching out to get as many students as he can involved as possible. He always has something to contribute to the conversations during professional development, is an active member of the school improvement team, and still finds time to oversee the yearbook production. These are only a few examples of how Mr. Rafter goes above and beyond. We want to thank him for his endless efforts in making Mattapique the best school that it can be, and another example of why Queen Anne's County Public Schools is so awesome, because it's got people like you in it. Gotta come up. Come on. No.
All right. One, two, three. One more. One, two, three. Thank you.
Congratulations. We had one student that came in late.
I do want to recognize we had one student that was not here in the beginning of the awards ceremony, and I believe that that's Katie Stoltz, that's part of the Mattapique Elementary Bookmark Award. Would you please come forward with your family? How are you?
How are you all?
How are you?
Good.
Congratulations. I'm going to give that to you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. This is important.
All right, are you ready? One, two, three. Last one. One, two, three. Thank you.
Like there's spots in front of my
face.
I know,
I was having a little difficulty myself.
What is this? I know, this sounds so funny. That's when it'll cool down a little
leaving.
Bit. That's
I got it.
Just cool down a little bit.
Thank you.
Participation. Oh, never mind. I can't.
That's like this
big cup. My face will be covered.
Well, it's is this the same thing here?
I say if I can make it through here without bawling,
yeah.
Thanks for coming.
I did.
One that Isaiah won. That was like the best recognition we've ever had. That was cool.
That's so cute. And the little boy, he had the suspenders on. They were too tight, and then they were kind of floppy like that. It was so adorable. Oh.
Flavor.
I don't know. you can switch.
No, that is right.
Let me refresh. I read
this. It ended like 2 days ago.
I never get it. Congratulations.
I sent it to the wrong right. I sent it to the dance teacher.
He's the one.
We were wondering who it was. I'm gonna make another one right now to the right, right?
You know, I mean, come on.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that.
Stuff, you know how that.
Marcellus Bennett.
What's up, Silvero? How you doing?
Good luck.
Churchill.
She did it.
Nice to see you again. Bye bye, quiet lady.
I said, was it something we said?
You can just probably start, and I'll start reading the.
Okay. Next on the agenda is the citizen participation public comment.
We ask that all speakers keep in mind the following guidelines. Speakers should sign the roster, including your telephone number and address. Comments should be limited to 2 minutes in length. Comments longer than 2 minutes should be submitted in writing. Questions or statements to the board should relate to a recent agenda item, an agenda item that is expected to appear in the future, or a matter of general policy over the board, over which the board has authority. Please do not discuss items related to negotiations. Those items are to be discussed at the bargaining table. Citizen participation is not intended to be a question and answer session. If you have specific questions, the board will make an appropriate, will make sure appropriate staff member responds to your questions at a later date. The board respects your desire and right to convey your message freely, but asks a courtesy to this board and our citizens that you respect the board's request to refrain from naming citizens and calling names when offering your critique. Sorry, I have spots in front of my eyes from all the flashes. Please notice, if you do not adhere to our meeting protocol, you will be escorted out. At this time, we have Mr. Richard McNeil.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I wanted to take the opportunity to commend a lot of things that are going on and that you're well aware of, obviously, of everything going on here. But to start off, I want to publicly commend the performing arts teams, both high schools, for their fine, outstanding production of Cinderella and The Sound of Music. They were just wonderful, the talent that was there and how that came about. It was a great asset to this community just for the students to show off and their talents. And if my estimation is right, that is 10% of our high school students, both high schools together, were involved in those productions in one way or another, either on stage or behind the stage. So when you think of that 10% of our high school student population, to me that's outstanding. So to both high schools, I commend your departments on that. I want to thank the board for their continued support of the health care package for our retired people. I know budgets are tight, and I hope that you continue with that along the line. We all know that for retirees, a lot of times health care is one of the big expenses that they face and the challenges in doing that, so we appreciate that. Also want to recognize and honor all those that are going to be recognized this Friday. Big event, Teacher of the Year, plus all the support staff and everybody else. I know it's coming up in a couple days, and we'll be anxiously to see how that all plays out. I want to mention that in my mentoring with teachers, I have opportunity to stop in and see certain classes, like calculus classes at both high schools. It's amazing what our students are doing in there. Working together, solving problems, and getting prepared for the test. It was I was there today at a class, and just gives me good feelings that we have some students who are really working towards that test for the AP Physics. And just down the hall at Queen Anne's, I happened to stop in, there was a algebra class that had approximately 8 to 9 English language learners, students in there, and 7 students with an IEP plus other students. And the instruction that was going on in that room was outstanding. I commend the teacher for that. It was one of those classes where you talk about a real mixture of students in a room and trying to get through the language barrier and also give support for all the students that are going on there. It was just wonderful to see that. And if you're not out in the schools, I encourage you to do that because we have great teachers doing some great things and obviously some great students doing some really great things. Winter sports, they had a lot of the teams that made it to the playoffs. We had some that made it to the state. And the swim team did really well, and the basketball team at Kent Island, they didn't quite make it all the way, but they pushed hard on that. So we thank you for that. And also like to thank the board for the being on the process for the superintendent's interviews. I know you've got a big job, and I encourage you to reflect on the comments from the focus groups. I appreciate MABE and their organization of that. I think that was just well put together, and having the community groups and the teacher groups and the student groups and so forth being a part of that. I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McNeil.
Next on the list, we have Stephanie Anthony.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Stephanie Anthony. I'm a third grade teacher at Kennard Elementary School and a member of the teachers union. And I know that the calendar adjustments are on your agenda this evening, so I just wanted to come and speak on behalf of those. I worked very closely with a group of elementary school teachers to try to work and get those January PD days back into the calendar. And we knew in trying to make that happen that there had to be some manipulation of other days to comply with everything that we need to be in compliance with number of days that kids are in school and that teachers are in school. And I just wanted to come and support the adjustments that are going to be presented to you and to encourage you to support them also. Those days were very, very important to the teachers. Hopefully you received a lot of feedback from other teachers about them. And I hope that you will consider those amendments that are being presented. Thank you.
Great, thank you. There's nobody else on the list at this time. If anybody would like to come forward and speak who didn't put their name on the list. If not, that's it.
Okay, so we're gonna move on to our president, to our student board members. Sorry, guys. And I'm gonna leave it to you. Which one do you want to start?
I can go first since you did
the
pledge.
You go right ahead.
Hi, everyone. How is everyone today? We had a full room. Now it's not there anymore. So I'm going to start by talking about our scheduling. The guidance department and the staff of Kennard Island High School are currently working on the master schedule for the next school years since the students have already chosen their schedules. And on today, actually, the girls and boys varsity tennis teams will be playing against QA. I wish well to both.
She's a politician now.
I hope, but I wish.
On Friday, April 7th, like it was mentioned, the school systems gala will be held, and our coach, Mrs. Jamie Wilt, will be honored as Coach of the Year. On Wednesday, everyone knows this because everyone's excited, Wednesday, April 12th to Tuesday, April 18th, we have our spring break, and we will be holding a couple sporting events during spring break. There will be a holiday baseball tournament during the break, and then the boys lacrosse team has been approved, and will be traveling to South Carolina to compete in various games also during the break. On Thursday, April 20th, National Honor Society induction. This ceremony will be held promptly at 7 p.m., and this year over 40 students will be joining this prestigious academic group at our school. Also, on Monday, April 24th, we'll be having our Spanish Honor Society, and it's actually called Sociedad Honoraria Hispanica in Spanish, and I'm the president. induction will start at 6, and this year we will be inducting 20 students. On Thursday, April 27th is our prom promise, and that's that nice display of visuals of the bad consequences of drinking on prom night and how we shouldn't be doing that. So that should be a informative time. On Saturday, April 29th, we'll be having our actual senior prom. The theme is Bollywood Ball. I'm so excited. And I wanted to give a big thanks to all the local businesses that donated because it was extremely helpful. So thank you to you guys. And then we wanted to put a little spotlight on some of the students at our school. So students of the final course of the biomedical science pathway, the PLTW, is the medical interventions. And these students have been informing the student body about an issue that they are uninformed about. So the students of Madison Kelly, Kelly O'Connor, and Zach Reiser have focused their capstone project on concussions and the effects of them. These students have created Google forums that other students have completed in order to get gather data, interviewed a professional, and have posted posters and have passed out flyers about the information about concussions. And they've been working very hard, so we wanted to give them a shout out for their hard work. And that's all I have for you today.
Excellent.
All right. At QA, I'm going to start with recognitions first. Of course, after all of the QA kids that are here today, I'm very proud. I'm very happy with Isaiah, too. That made me almost cry. Emma Peterson, Ruth Murdoch, and Connor Allen have all received the Carson Scholarship Funds, and they will be honored on April 30th. Cindy Kay, who was here earlier, and Kelly Van Dyke's artwork have been chosen to be displayed at the House of Delegates in Annapolis. So Cindy's doing a lot with her art. I'm very proud of her. Bibi Montoya was awarded second place, and Cindy Kay, honorable mention, at the annual Academy of Arts Mid-Short Exhibition. And that's all with recognitions. We have a lot going on this month, and we had a lot going on last month. April 11th is our picture day for sports. And then our spring break is also the 12th through the 18th, so I'm ready for that one. And then when we get back on April 19th, it is NHS induction. So if you would like to come out and support, that would be great. April 26th, our Interact Club, which I'm the president, we're doing Stop Hunger Now. And it's a really awesome opportunity if any of you guys haven't done it. We raised a lot of money to be able to do it, so we're very excited that they're coming. And if you guys would like to come out, it'll be at around 3 and help us pack bags. Excellent. It'll be much appreciated. It's an awesome time.
Excellent.
April 29th. We have our Relay for Life, as well as our prom, just like Kent Island. April 25th will be our prom promise, though. Well, as Anam already mentioned, Kent Island and QA tennis tonight, so we'll see how that goes. Our tennis team's undefeated, so.
Oh, I try to be nice.
And then other stuff that has happened throughout the month. We just made a paper called the Pride Post, so we're very excited. That's our first newspaper that Queen Anne's has ever done, so it's actually looked really good. The PBIS team did Random Acts of Kindness Week, and it leaded up to our QA's Got Talent, which was on March 30th. My mom was a judge. She said it was really cool. We had our All Shore Band Festival on March 31st and April 1st, and that's all.
I didn't get to say this, but shout out to Mr. Harding. We are all excited for your presentation later tonight.
And Mr. Kelly.
And Mr. Kelly, everyone.
And your shout out.
Let's keep it fair, ladies.
I had Mr. Kelly, too. Hi, Mr. Kelly. How are you?
Yeah. I need to break.
Okay, so now we can move on to those presentations.
Yeah. Got 6.01. We'll start with Mrs. Hoban, who will be, and I believe Mrs. Pauls is going to be joining her, giving you an update, kind of a little bit of a status about our elementary and secondary reading data and some of the things that Bridget and Ms. Pauls have been working on with our teachers and curriculum and...
He's not going to leave it up.
Mr. Bender.
Slacking.
Are these loaded up?
White. Or Robin Hood, yeah. Nice to see you. Shutting down.
Oh, we need
spring break is here. Just call it now. Okay.
They were all loaded on there.
Thank you.
Hmm?
You're on the computer.
I don't know.
That way turns it off, turn off the whole computer.
Everything was on. So while we're waiting, I'll just start to talk a little bit about what we're going to see today. So Bridget and I, and it's my honor to have Bridget here with me, are going to share the data for ELA. And we know that once Dr. O'Neill left, Bridget kind of assumed some additional responsibilities, so we really have been tag-teaming a lot with the elementary school. So I'd like to take the time to publicly thank her for the additional work that she has signed on for. So I had the opportunity to meet the last meeting with the reading teachers, and during that time we were compiling a lot of this data, and as a result of that data, Bridget and I had the opportunity to put together the presentation for you tonight, and we're going to share, beginning with the elementary, which is trimester data. As you know, because of the progress reports, the data is reported for each trimester. Now, last year we did a pre and a post for grades 1 and 2, and then for grades 3 to 5. It was in September and May. So this really is the first time, I don't know what's going on. So this really is the first time that we have given the assessments for the entire year. And we have found some issues with some of the assessments, which we have worked on during our monthly meetings and will continue to work on during the summer. So the assessments are purely diagnostic in nature, which means that we, after each assessment is administered, we go back and we look at the standard for each of the assessment items. And we also do an item analysis to kind of get an idea of whether it was a good item or not a good item, depending on the data that we receive. We then use that information at the classroom level to provide instruction, whether if the students perform really well on that standard, we may need to make sure that it's at a higher level of rigor, depending on their level, and then if students struggle with that, we would need to provide some additional support. So at the school levels, they really have the opportunity to do some differentiation as they receive that information back to the schools. So what we did is we compiled it by grade level, and we looked at the strengths and weaknesses for each of those grade levels. And then we kind of came to some type of consensus as to what we saw as some generalities, and then what would be next steps for instruction. And as soon as we get it up, that's what we're going to share. Which is,
I don't know who turned the computer off.
Oh, was it me?
It wasn't me. It was up.
I have it in. We have it on our computers.
Public doesn't.
Okay, I can go and speak from here, over here. If that's would be a better use of time.
Take a break.
Have it, although it is on board docs.
On the docs. Yes.
If the board would like us to proceed.
Whatever you
we'll
want.
We'll do that.
Everybody's
okay?
Yeah.
If we'll you proceed. Would speak from the slides would be fine.
Ms. Hoban, do you need a computer to look at it? I mean, I have.
Just pull
you
up
have
up
it on
have
your
screens right
okay.
in front of me.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Is it coming up?
I'm trying.
Okay. So our rationale is that the trimester, the assessments are administered 3 times a year for each of the trimesters. And these assessments are aligned with Common Core standards and are diagnostic in nature. Our purpose today is to share that data with you, to share disparities in the data, and to provide support to schools. So we really looked at 2 different areas for each of the grade levels in grades 2 to 5. We looked at the research standard and we looked at literary standards. And at with the research standard, we had 2 types of texts, and students had to demonstrate understanding of the subject for those texts that they had to read. It's very short text and sustained research project. And then for literary, which is your fiction type stories, some of them were poems, they had to draw evidence from those literary texts and then be able to make an analysis. So for grade one, it was a little bit different because, of course, they come to us and they're just learning how to read. So we really work with some shorter assessments by unit. And then we gave them a longer assessment, which was their benchmark assessment. And you can see those students did very well. The way that it is displayed, it shows the number of students that were proficient, the number of students that were basic, and then the change from the first to the second assessment administration. We can see the strengths were EL student performance, where they were asking and answering questions and sight words, and this assessment was read to the students. And then some weaknesses, again, in the second administration, the students did not do as well, but it's because of the number of words that and the content, the context of the stories that were being read. It was a lot more details. In grade two, now this is the assessment that we're really struggling with. The students did not do well on this assessment. And so we went back and we looked at it, and it was about rocket science. And the title of it was, It's Not Rocket Science. And it was very difficult for students to be able to understand at that particular level. So we know we need to change that, the reading selection out with that. So the first trimester, students did not do very well. We only had 18% proficient, but we did see a significant increase, change agent of 51. With the second trimester, and then again with literary, it was a 21% increase. And so you can see the strengths were, again, asking and answering questions, describing words and phrases. And then it gets, as the standard gets a little bit more difficult, you can see that it was more difficult for students, such as identifying the main topic, but not just of a one paragraph, of a multi-paragraph. And again, this is grade two students, and it's scientific concepts, so it does get a little bit more difficult. Grade three, we did have a change agent of 27 points, and then with research, and then 7 points with the literary. So you can see how the students perform, and we just had it broken out for the number of students that were proficient and the number of students that were basic, and you can see our strengths and our weaknesses. We did start to identify some needs with our subgroup populations here, and our special ed students and African American students did not do as well. Grade four, there was no change, but they at least did not decrease. Stayed significantly, stayed pretty much the same. And then literary, there was a small increase there. So we'll have to go back again and pay close attention to that assessment as well. And then grade five, the standards get increasingly more difficult, but you can see this is where we saw some of our greater gains with our students, and 27% change with the research and 34% with the literary, and that's where students were comparing and contrasting two or more characters. Vocabulary was on every assessment, and we did see a significant gain with our GT student performance. I also want to mention that in the first grade, students just had to respond, and they had a selected response A, B, or C. But when you get to grades 2 to 5, the assessment is set up very much like PARC. And so they have an A and a B type answer. So I provided like a couple of examples to give you an idea. One with the vocabulary on grade three assessment was, what does the word founding mean? And then they have to go back in the reading and find the phrase that helps to explain the meaning of that word. So that we think is another reason why perhaps our second grade students did not perform as well, because they're not accustomed to that type of assessment. But we're getting them ready for PARC, and that's how PARC will be assessed. Another one was an example was, what's the main idea, and then they had to give two details to support the main idea. So it's not an easy assessment, and we're happy we're okay with our data, except for in the areas where we know it's the assessment, but we know we need to continue to move our students to higher standards. Okay, So our next steps, we definitely know we need to go back and increase the rigor of the expectations for standards. And as Mr. Paluski and some of the supervisors, Ms. Hoban was one, and also Mr. Page, when we visited the schools, this was something that we saw countywide. That was something that we need to work on. And we started to work on that during our A&S meetings. We also need to go back and work with lesson alignment, making sure that the essential question or objective is aligned with the standard and assessment. Increasing stamina, our students often give up. These are longer assessments that students have to sit for, and we need to make sure that they can endure the entire time for it. Even though we have it broken out into days, it's still a longer period of time for students, over an hour in some cases, where they have to continue to work through the assessment. We're looking at some additional interventions for special education students, and this is something we're also looking at with one of our innovation teams, I think team five. And then we're looking at some additional professional development for special educators. Excuse me, because countywide we see great gaps with special ed, more so than in any other groups. So we have started already. Ms. McGowan has come in and worked with our teacher specialist, and she's also worked with our reading specialist. She's going to do a presentation tomorrow with our A&S team. So we're getting everyone on board, and we're coming up with a plan for closing that gap with special education. Excuse me, questions? No questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Pauls. To the secondary piece.
Is that open? Computer issues. I think our computer is dying.
Ms. Landgraf, do we have some funds in our current budget to maybe upgrade our computer equipment here in the Board of Ed?
We'll have that conversation with Mr. Combs.
Please. It's here. You guys can't see it.
Oh, it does.
And I... It's the ring of death.
Yep. Well, maybe Ms. Hoban, if you could just speak from the slides would be great, as the board has those in front of them.
Wonderful. Good evening, board members, members of the executive team. I'm Bridget Hoban. As Ms. Paul said, I was hired as secondary English Language Arts and World Languages Supervisor. I'm also currently serving as interim elementary supervisor, so it's been a very exciting 7 months. As you know, our students and teachers have been working really hard this year. My purpose tonight is to show you what they've been doing, along with the leadership in our building, our English chairs and reading specialists, to show progress on that hard work. So I'm going to share with you some qualitative data and some quantitative data, and both to kind of encourage that the work we are doing is important in moving student achievement forward. So I will share school and county initiatives, as well as the direction we're headed for this summer and next year. That being said, our objective is to provide you with information regarding English and language arts progress, current initiatives, and next steps. When I first arrived in August, I was presented with this tangible resource that was really vital in my learning more about Queen Anne's County Public Schools, and that was the curriculum audit. So I really worked to become familiar with the recommendations that the audit had, the findings and the standards, and my literary mind went to the notion of looking at reoccurring themes. And while I saw good things happening, I also saw a reoccurring theme for the need of consistency. Consistency in planning, consistency in implementation, consistency in assessment. So some of the work that I've done to make sure that what I'm seeing as the supervisor matches what's happening in the audit is to go into each classroom, untenured and tenured teachers, and conduct school-wide learning walks, but also provide individual feedback to each teacher. So I've been able to get into every middle school and provide feedback to those English language arts teachers and world languages teachers, as well as to Queen Anne's County High School. Kent Island is at the end of the month. So what I've seen are some consistent strengths, and those strengths are noted on the slide for you. All of our teachers are teaching to those college and career readiness standards, and they're using the resources that our county dollars have purchased for them. Collections text in middle school, My Perspectives by Pearson in high school. Management in classrooms is really strong. We have really structured, really respectful learning environments. That's hard to teach, that's hard to coach. So it's really wonderful to see that excellent management already in place in all our schools. Our teachers are content experts, and you can see that in the manner in which they deliver content. Their academic vocabulary, their expertise on literary devices, the structure of an argument, how to approach informational text. So we have a lot of things working in our favors in terms of what our English language arts teachers at the middle and high school level are doing. That being said, there are also some opportunities for growth, and you'll see that noted on the recommendations side of your slide. And one of the things that are working mostly with the reading specialists and English chairs to start is the notion of measurable objectives, so that the skill that students are learning and the assessment are posted and visible for anybody visiting. And most importantly, are accessible to our kids, that our kids understand the language of them, understand what's expected, and how we're going to figure out that they've learned it. I'd like to encourage, and the chairs and specialists are supporting it in their schools, the notion of increasing accountability. And that's mostly through equitable questioning, making sure we're not just relying on the cold calling technique or calling on the same student who raises their hand over and over again, that we're giving students time to think and pair and share, that we're encouraging students to call on one another to really hone a learner-centered environment. So that's a piece we've developed. We put professional development in place in the middle and high school days in the fall. Instruction, recommendation to increase learner-centeredness. And the notion of learner-centeredness picked up some speed in 2012. As a nation, and is kind of making its way into our language and our dialogue, our professional dialogue in the state of Maryland, and now, thankfully, into Queen Anne's County's classrooms. And that's been really exciting to watch and be part of. So these are the pieces that I found from a qualitative perspective. I do want to note that the next piece is quantitative, and in the interest of time, it is related to the high school, and it focuses mostly on English 2 data with the local assessments, because English 2 has the state test at the end of the course and is really imperative in helping students graduate and getting students across the stage. So your next slide you should see is titled English 2 Progress. It says English 2 Final Exam 2016. So this data was pulled from our platform, our Performance Matters platform. So you'll note that the majority of our high school English 2 students, when they were tested in January, scored in proficient or advanced. And you'll note there that I put information on both the high schools. The way that our platform Performance Matters reports data is in the category of basic, which is students earning 0 to 59%, proficient 60 to 79% and advanced 80% or higher. Over 100 of the 279 English 2 students tested, over 100 of them placed in that advanced category. So that's really exciting. I drilled down a little bit on the proficiency piece and looked at the difference between students earning 60 to 69 and 70 to 79, and 45% of them earned 70 or higher. So we're in really good shape. This assessment, forgive me for not mentioning that this assessment mimics the literary analysis on PARC, which is unit 1 of the PARC test. So students are tested on reading literature skills and then on writing informative or explanatory text, and all that is captured in this data. So this news, this progress shows that things are working well in our English 2 classrooms, and we have a couple of things in place that we're doing to further support this progress. If you look at the English 2 initiative slide, one of the other resources I received when I joined Queen Anne's in August was a list of what teachers would like, especially from a professional development standpoint. And the high school English teachers really wanted some work in range finding. So I worked with teachers from each high school, and we put together this professional development day where they looked at PCRs, which are, we understand mostly as the essay part of PARC or of our local assessments. And we took a sampling of a variety of different scores and status content teams to score them using the PARC rubric so that we could all be understanding how each of us was interpreting the PARC rubric and making sure that there was consistency in how we were scoring. So teachers in turn developed, or content teams developed, action steps for moving writing instruction forward and use them for the rest of the semester and now in this semester's instruction as well. The English 2 teams, and I really need to commend the English 2 team at Queen Anne's County High School and Miss Leanna Bennett at Kent Island High School. They have taken their own time to work with me during their planning time outside of school hours to develop a pilot unit. And each high school got to decide what they wanted their pilot unit to be on. Did they want it to focus on the literary analysis task or the research simulation? And our teachers were really mindful of the data from previous years. So both schools selected working on reading informational text and designing a summative assessment that mimicked PARC's research simulation task. And so I've worked with each team. Each team, incidentally, selected Unit 3 from our My Perspectives text to develop that unit around. They drafted a prompt, and they each drafted 4 lessons for that pilot unit, and they're going to implement it after spring break. We worked to develop local assessments that we put in Unify so we could diagnose our students, use that data to personalize and customize instruction. And then we also developed a midpoint that we'll use as well to kind of gauge this pilot unit. And then they will provide feedback while they're implementing it. And we'll look at that feedback during the summer when we have some time to sit with it and look at what both schools did and how they did it and take some best practices and share some lessons learned during that time. A data deep dive. I conducted it with both teams over the past week. And so a data deep dive, as you know, involves really looking at the question, seeing what students chose, and looking at questions that they answered incorrectly and looking at why they answered it incorrectly, and then looking at what instructional strategies we need to implement to move that conversation forward or to move that instruction forward and that achievement level forward. So we had really great specific conversations about different things we needed to build into this supplemental pilot unit to make sure students were understanding the skills with reading informational text and writing to inform or explain. That is all the excitement on the high school front. Are there any questions so far on high school, or I'll transition to the middle school piece? Okay. Middle school progress. So you'll see there the information on 7th and 8th grade pre-assessments. Currently, right now, the reading specialists are working to edit and revise the post-assessments. In terms of consistency, which I spoke of earlier, there isn't a midpoint local assessment that's countywide. Each middle school uses their own midterm. So that is something that the reading specialists are really encouraging, and the work we're doing in our meetings currently has us collecting and looking at each other's midpoint assessments so we can make that a consistent assessment and drive instruction with more consistent data across the county in all our middle schools. So that's an important piece. This is the data where students were in August, and I won't have the post data obviously until the end of the school year. We have some really exciting initiatives happening in the middle school. A few months ago, our HMH, our collections text team, approached us with an opportunity to work with 2 teachers to provide an in-house professional learning opportunity. So HMH has provided a content specialist, and we polled principals, and principals determined expert teachers, because the goal was if we can work with these expert teachers, then they in turn can create and implement PD at their own middle schools and then countywide in August. So the content specialist is working to show them the student-facing or digital resources that our textbook collection has available, as well as how to use different data and build text complexity. We just had our first status phone call yesterday afternoon. And what I appreciated most, again, in looking for reoccurrent themes was the notion of customization. Customizing instruction based on the teacher's style and voice, and using student data to customize instructions so that we're meeting kids where they are and helping to enrich them, accelerate them, or remediate them if needed. So that's a really exciting initiative that we have working at two of our middle schools. We also just this week launched LightSail, which is a pilot online reading program. This is not an intervention. This is something we're looking at to maybe supplement our English language arts blocks next year. Teachers can go in and select text based on the topics or the themes that they're teaching, and those texts can be adjusted to meet student reading levels where they are. What's cool about LightSail, for lack of a better term, is that there's embedded assessments. So the students are consistently gauged at their progress and fluency in reading comprehension, and the text adjusts accordingly. So this is a really interesting program. I should have data by middle of next week, right before we go on break, to see how the first week went. Data deep dive, professional development has been provided to the reading specialists. They were having great conversations in their middle schools in any event, but this gave them another approach to looking at the data, drilling down to the standard, and making decisions to move student learning and student achievement forward. So lots going on at the middle school as well. Next steps, three big ones. We have summer curriculum writing coming our way, which we're going to be working on things with at both the middle and the high school level, and working at creating pilot units and resources and different assessments that mirror college and career readiness standards and use our county resources. Vertical teaming has been a major request, and so we're looking to build in a great opportunity there when everyone's in one place in August and get surrounding grades to talk to one another so that they can understand where students are and where they need to head, and continued work on drilling down on our data to make sure that our students are getting the best instruction each day, every day. I think that's it for me. Questions? Yeah.
Excellent job.
The online reading program, say it's a pilot, is it that the reading specialists are going to use for intervention? Is that the?
No, it's not. It won't be an intervention. It'll be a complement to or a supplement, possible supplement to our language arts curriculum. So we're looking at it as another layer when we look at our data and decide, you know, we need an extra support because students are working ahead or students need some enrichment or remediation. This may be something that we can look at incorporating or weaving into our instruction for next year.
Yeah, right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Hoban.
Nice job.
Great job.
Before we move on to Ms. Landgraf's legislative audit, could we take a 5-minute break, please?
Sure.
Yeah. To move on to Mrs. Landgraf for the legislative audit?
No.
So one of the things is she's getting ready to present that I wanted to make sure that the board is well aware that we currently are under a legislative audit. This will be the third legislative audit. The auditors are here. They've been here since January. They will conclude sometime in July. We'll expect that report sometime in the fall. Mrs. Landgraf, we wanted to provide you a little bit of an overview because those past audit reports, I believe that you were not on the board at that time. And so she's going to give an overview of kind of the legislative audit process as well as the past two and what we can maybe anticipate for the third.
Yes. So, as he said, the legislative auditors are here. They began working with us about January 9th, and they will continue to be here through the beginning of June. And essentially what I wanted to do tonight was just tell you, give you a brief overview. Who are they? What are they here? What are they auditing? Why are we being audited? Have we been audited by them in the past? What were our findings in the past? And what we have done to try to eliminate those findings for the future. So who are the legislative auditors? They are a department. They are part of the Office of Legislative Services at the state of Maryland. There's about 350 people who make up the Department of Legislative Services, and the audit group is one branch of that. They provide a wide variety of services to the General Assembly when they are in session, and even when they're not. They write a lot of the bills. They give them technical support, financial support, those kinds of things. We get contacted occasionally to give fiscal notes about certain bills that are in, what's that going to cost the school board to do those bills, those kinds of things. That's what the Legislative Office of Legislative Services does. Basically, the Office of Legislative Auditors are part of that. They report back to the Joint Audit Committee. They're supposedly independent, nonpartisan group that reports to the Joint Audit Committee. Once they do that, the Joint Audit Committee takes whatever they gather from all the audits that have been performed, and they do a presentation to the General Assembly. Why are we being audited? Well, I don't know how many of you were attuned to what was going on in education back in 1999, but in 1999, they set up a commission, the General Assembly did, to look at school funding and how we could improve school funding. It was better known as the Thornton Commission, and I'm sure you've all heard of the Thornton Commission. So they were reviewing current financing formulas and accountability measures for all the public schools in the state of Maryland. The commission issued their final report in 2002, and as part of that report, what they said was the state needed to give public schools more money. So over the next 6 years, from 2003 to 2008, the state did give public schools more money, to the tune of about $2.2 billion more. What happened during that time also were there were several school systems, PG County and Baltimore City were the two big ones, that had some financial difficulties, and they ran deficits a couple years in a row in those counties. So the General Assembly kind of sat back and said, wait, you know, we're giving all this new money to these county schools, but yet they're running deficits. We need somebody to go out there and look at what they're spending this money on and if they're being responsible for it. So that's where the Office of Legislative Audits came from for school boards. So in 2004, they passed a bill, the Education Fiscal Accountability and Oversight Bill, which required all the school boards to be audited one time in the next 6 years by the Department of Legislative Services. That was the initial bill. They came back as time has gone on and they have reviewed some of these audits and said, okay, we're now going to make this every 6 years all of the school boards in the state of Maryland have to be audited. So every 6 years they have come. This is our third round with them. A new bill was passed in the current legislative session, actually last legislative session, not the one that's currently still in session, but last year, that said if you want to be exempt from these audits, because a lot of the counties, especially in a small county like this, where they're here from January to June, and it takes a lot of resources, a lot of questions being answered, a lot of time out of our day, you know, working with these auditors, the legislation said, well, if you want to not have the audit, if you want to have the audit waived, you can do that. But in order to do that, your school board, your county commissioners, your representative to the Senate, and your representative to the House all have to write a letter and request that that be done. Seven counties actually did that and had their audits waived for this next round of audits. But it can only be a one-time thing. So they will be audited in 12 years when that comes back around. So what is being audited? It's going ahead of me here. General planning, basically they look at statistical information, they compare us to other counties our size, they see if any of our expenditures are out of whack with other counties our size or within the state, and then that would be an area that they would look at. The revenue and the billing cycles, they look at how we collect revenues, what our processes are, how we record it, to make sure that all of that is promptly deposited. And they review our accounts receivable to make sure that any monies that were due, we're billing for and we're collecting. Grants, they really don't do a lot in the federal grants department, only because we already get a compliance audit from our independent auditors that look at all of the grants and how they're being spent and whether we're compliant with the grant regulations or not. They look at our procurement and disbursement cycles, and this is where they spend a lot of time, is looking at this. They look at how are you buying? Are you buying any large items? And when you do, are you getting that competitively bid? Are you making sure that you're getting the best pricing that you can get on those things? They look at human resources, the practices and of human resources and how we produce payroll. Our largest expenditure, as we have said many times as we've gone through the budget, is payroll. So, 80% of our expenses are on payroll and benefits, so that's an area that they hone in and they look at. Inventory control and accountability in both materials and supplies and on property. Materials and supplies, they're making sure that they're just kind of looking to see that we're not wasteful in what we're purchasing, that what we're purchasing are reasonable purchases for a school system. As far as the property goes, they look at whether we have inventory control. Essentially, our cutoff is anything over $1,000, we have to record it as a fixed asset. We put a tag on it and we trace it. Every year we send inventories out to the schools and they verify that those things are still in their building. So they're just making sure that what our policies are, that we're actually following them and that we're tracking things. Information technology, this is an area that they look at, and actually it's a separate set of auditors will come and do this area. And they will look at, what are your passwords, who has access to what information, look at your network and your firewalls and your disaster recovery plans, all those kinds of things. So they will look at all that, yeah. Physical plant, they look at the facility planning and the construction renovation. How's the planning practice? What are our policies regarding hiring architects? As far as, getting projects approved and constructed, procuring the bidding process, the monitoring of those projects, all of those types of things. Then they get into maintenance and operations. In this area, they look at our cost, what our maintenance and operation costs are against national and regional benchmarks, whether we seem to have a reasonable amount spent in those. They review our preventative maintenance plan and look at our facilities and determine whether they've been properly maintained or not. And then they look at workload formulas for measuring efficiency of our employees. Then they go on to student transportation, and I will say that they spend a lot of time in student transportation. Transportation, they compare the number of miles that we're paying a contractor for, and they will sit down and measure out that route and determine whether we're paying them for too many or too less miles, and the number of hours that we're paying. They look at the PVA formulas. Look at purchasing of buses. There's a lot that they look at in that area. Food service, because we contract out our food service, they really aren't going to do much in this area. They've reviewed the contract that we have with our with Sodexo, and they're making sure that we're paying according to that contract. But because Sodexo is responsible for most of the day-to-day operations of that, they will not be reviewing much of that. And then they go on to look at the school board operations and oversight. And basically what they're looking for there is, are you getting financial information? Are you setting policies? Are we following the policies that you've set? Is everything being independently overseen? And they look at the performance data along with financial data that's is made available to you on a timely basis. And then after that, last but not least, other financial controls and miscellaneous issues. This is kind of a catch-all. If there's anything that catches their eye when they're here as they're going through all of those other things, then this is where that would fall. One of the things that they asked about a couple years ago was whether we had had a health audit, whether we had looked at the dependents that were riding on our health care, and were they actually legitimate dependents for all of our people. And we did an audit. We hired a company to come in and contact all of our employees and verify birth certificates and marriage certificates and all of that kind of thing to make sure that we only had the people on our policy that needed to be on there. So, have we been audited by them before? Yes, this is our third time. The first report was issued in October of 2006. There were 12 recommendations in that report, spread over 10 of those 12 areas that we just discussed. And at that point in time, we were actually required, the superintendent and I had to go and meet with the Joint Audit Committee of the General Assembly, and if they had any questions regarding any of the findings in our audit, we had to speak to them. The second report was issued in October of 2011. That report, they began field work in August of 2010. They completed it in March of 2011, and the report was finally issued in October of 2011. We had 18 recommendations in that audit, and I have given you a second, there's a second document attached on your board docs which lists all 18 of the findings in that particular audit and what our responses to those findings were. Essentially, the overall theme of the findings that we have with the legislative audit, verification and documentation. One of the things that they've been asking us about, the biggest question that has come with this audit is, okay, you've decided that you're going to piggyback on Baltimore County schools for school buses. How do you know that's the best bid to piggyback? Which our answer is, Baltimore County is one of the biggest counties in the state. They buy more school buses than anybody, so it would be logical that they would have the best price. So piggybacking on there, do you have any documentation to prove that? And that's you know, kind of where we fall down as a small county. You know, we wear 10 hats every day, and a lot of those small things, which I don't think is, you know, a big thing. We've thought it through. We made a logical decision. We just don't have documentation of it. So that's the verification and the documentation. Internal controls, basically what I mean by that is that we have small offices. We wear many hats. So sometimes we have jobs that are kind of against one another. For example, me personally, I am the person that goes into the payroll system and moves everybody up a step when it's time to do that. Well, that includes me. Well, somebody's got to do it. No matter who does it in the system, somebody's got to be the person that's going to be touching their own salary. And because of my position, they think it should be somebody lower than me and that I should be the person reviewing what's being done. So, you know, there's some of those kinds of things. It's a segregation of duty type thing, which is the next thing that I talk, that, you know, have listed there. And then the last thing is policy development, and I think we've been working really hard on our policy development over the last couple years, so I think we're getting better there. So there is a separate document there. You can read through those findings and our responses to those findings. And a lot of it has to do with that segregation of duty and us just being a small county. I'll tell you kind of a funny story. The first time they came, they sent me a letter and they said, you know, we need to meet. We would like to have our entrance conference with the superintendent, the chief financial officer, the chief budget officer, the financial liaison to the superintendent, the, you know, and they named about six different positions, and I said, okay, the superintendent, I'll be there. You know, it was because all of those hats was either the superintendent or myself wore those hats, and it was about 10 different positions. So in the bigger counties, a lot of these jobs are able to be, you know, segregated, and people have very specific things that they do. But in the smaller counties, you know, we're doing it all. The actual audit reports are located on the Office of Legislative Audit's website, and I've put the site there. The field work on the current audit, they're telling me, should be completed by the first part of June. We should receive what they call discussion notes. All of their findings, they'll write up and they'll give them to us in discussion notes, and we'll have an opportunity to defend ourselves, to, you know, to give them additional documentation, to be able to get some of those things not to show up in the final report. And then the final report will be probably issued late winter, early spring, sometime next year, about this time next year. So that's kind of where we are. We anticipate that we will have findings again, because we have, you know, some of the same issues that we had then, we still have. There's still a problem with segregation of duties. There's still a problem with us being a small county. So we do anticipate that we will have those comments.
That was my question. So of the recommendations in 2006, how many were repeated in 2011? And do we sort of expect them to be repeated again?
Yes, some of them I would expect to be repeated again.
For the very ideas you just laid out.
Right.
That is lack of segregation, not enough bodies to do X number of jobs.
Some of them weren't repeated in the second. Some of them were repeated. I would say probably half and half.
It wasn't all of them.
It wasn't all of them. But they looked at different things the second time they came. Like the first time they came, Sid was very excited because one of their recommendations was that we hired additional seven maintenance men.
I still look in.
And obviously that's not something a small county could do. In that first audit report, they said that we should hire an internal auditor. Well, for a county this size, we don't need a full-time internal auditor. You know, so there was some of those kinds of things that we really didn't need to do, or we couldn't do because of our budget constraints. So in the second audit, when they came back, they looked at different things. They looked at some of the same things, but they looked at some different things, and they had a different perspective by that time too.
I was going to ask, how accepting are they of that when they come back and find that we really did not have the resources to do all the things they wanted us to do, and we're probably going to find the same small, a certain number of things again still being done sort of different than they would like us to do? What do they recommend for that?
They really don't have a recommendation for that, because I asked that question. I said, you know, you have this problem with segregation. Can you give me a suggestion of how to remedy it? No. Additional staff was the answer. And I was like, additional staff isn't, you know, that's not going to work. And the other thing that we have in a small county, too, is we have cross-training of jobs, you know, so that if something happens to somebody, we can still get that work done. You know, so in addition to the two people that I have that normally run accounts payable, I have two other people who are also trained to do that job and have access to do that job, but don't do it on a daily basis. And that's one of the things that they have a problem with, is these second people who don't, that's not necessary for their normal job, have access to do this other job. So that, you know, it's all because we're a small county, a lot of it.
Robin, just a real quick question. When we do receive the report, will the auditors do a presentation to the board, a modified version of the findings?
They can.
From years past?
The first time that we had the audit done, they did not do that.
Okay.
The second time we had the audit done, the board requested that they did it. So that's up to you. If you want a presentation from them, they will come in and do a presentation. Okay, any other questions? All right, thanks. Thank you.
We'll move on to our final third. I'll kind of turn it over to Mr. Pender, as well as, I believe, Mr. Kelly and Mr. Harding are going to give us a very brief overview of athletics.
Yes, Mr. Paluski had requested us, both athletic directors and myself, to give a presentation, just basically outlining how many student athletes we have involved at both high schools. Basically what the cost associated With those are gate receipts and also the annual budget that comes through. We also have unified athletics. And then we had some stats up there because I wanted to show you also how often the two high school athletic trainers are used and what are some of the benefits that we've seen out of that. So that's been well worth putting in the budget. So I want to turn it over to Dan Harding and Brian Kelly, and I hope Mr. Harding does not disappoint you in his presentation.
Yeah, there's a lot of pressure all of a sudden. I was thinking I was coming just to speak to the board, but forgot that Anam's going to be critiquing my...
I'm on the board.
I understand. Yeah, already,
She is the board.
That's correct.
Welcome, gentlemen. Okay.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you.
So, as Mr. Pinder mentioned, we're going to really do a brief overview, Brian and I will, of the overall successes. Really went back the last 2 years for both Kent Island High School and Queen Anne's County High School. And so we'll get started. Apparently we're having technical difficulty. There we go.
Look at you.
That's not showing up there. Hold on 1 second. So perhaps it wasn't just the...
There's something down here.
I don't know.
Click on that one.
It's off of their laptop.
It's off of Mr. Page.
Could it be hooked up to a different presentation?
Just go ahead and present it off the...
I do have a hard copy if you just want me to get started. I understand this has been an evening of...
Yeah, just go ahead. Yeah, I would just, sorry, you know, speak. They have the slides.
Sure.
We have it on here, so we can
all right,
see it.
Go ahead.
So let me just go ahead and get started. Like I said, looking at the last 2 years. Well, there we go.
And we're back.
First thing I said. All right, so again, to review the last 2 years, I mentioned that. I'm going to slide ahead. All right, so Kent Island High School 2015-16, we had 394 athletes participate in the fall 2015. You can see the breakdown there. We had 271 athletes participate in our winter, which begins in 2015 and then crosses over to 2016. And then again, another 308 athletes participated in spring 2016. Most notably, and I mention this every time I have a sports award banquet or anytime I can, that really most impressive for both high schools, but in Kent Island High School's case, for 2015-16, 70% of our athletes were awarded the State Mind in Motion Award, and that's a minimum of a 3.25 GPA. In addition, we had a few Bayside championships, some regional championships, and one state championship. I'll go ahead and hit you here.
Thank you. Queen Anne's County, we had 380 athletes participate in the fall 2015. 276 in the winter, and 318 in the spring. Like Dan, you know, it's pretty impressive. These kids put a lot of time out on the field, and they keep up their grades. So 65% of our athletes were awarded the Minds in Motion in 2015-16. And we had two regional championships last year, baseball and women's lacrosse.
So carrying over into 2016-17, this fall, 405 athletes. The winter had 286, and currently in the spring, which is obviously really just started, 317 athletes at Kent Island High School. Again, and we've maintained about this number, 72% were able to maintain a 3.25 minimum GPA or higher, and therefore, really, we are projecting at the end of the year that they will receive a Minds in Motion Award. Picked up so far 5 Bayside championships, 5 regional championships, as well as 2 state championships, both of which are for our cheerleading team that won the state championship for the fall and winter. So very impressive there.
In Queen Anne's County this year, we had 360 athletes in the fall, 252 in the winter, 298 currently in the spring. Again, pretty steady with 65% of our athletes awarded Minds in Motion. And this year we've had 2 regional championships, field hockey and women's swimming, and 2 state champions, and those are 2 individuals, or 2-time state champions in women's in each of their events.
Impressive with no pool.
Yep.
Really, what we look to do as well, we didn't want to exclude them, we really wanted to highlight our unified athletes. So we offer three seasons of unified athletics. We had 8 individuals, athletes participate in our fall, which is tennis. 11 participated in the winter in 2015-16, which is our unified weight training, strength and conditioning. And then another 11 athletes in 2015-16, which participated in bocce ball. In 16-17, we saw an increase in both the fall and winter, as well as a larger increase in the spring. At Kenan High School and Queen Anne's County High School, we're really, thanks to the Board of Education and funding from Queen Anne's County Public School, we're able to put very nice bocce ball courts. And I know for Kenan High School, that's what resulted in a number of those increases for spring 2017.
Lock up again?
No.
There it is. Okay, so last year, again, the Unified Arts team, we participated in 3 seasons last year with 22 athletes in the fall, 16 in the winter, and 11 in the spring. This year, we were pretty unfortunate in the fall as our current tennis coach for Unified Arts, she stepped up and took a position with Special Olympics that didn't allow her to coach at the timing. It was not a good timing as we came back to school. And we did everything, trying to get people interested in doing the tennis. I did have an individual commit to it probably a week before the championships. It was too late at that time, so we really missed out on that, which was unfortunate. But we did have the winter with the strength and conditioning, and then we also have right now our bocce with 15 athletes.
All right, good.
I was going to say, starring our honoree tonight, Isaiah Dodd.
So athletic funding, really, this part, the Board of Education's allotted funds has remained the constant $48,750 since I started, as well as in 2015-16 and 16-17. Our seasonal gate receipts for Kenan High School, the total for 2015-16 was just over $35,000. Currently, right now, for 16-17, it's sitting at a little over $41,000, not including the spring. Full disclosure, spring doesn't bring a large gate, and the biggest reason for the increase in 16-17 was we hosted the Kenan High School versus Queen Anne's County High School football, varsity football game this year, and that normally will fluctuate us a good 3,000 to 4,000, as well as a lot of our coaches have made it an effort to try and get the local communities out. We have rec teams at halftime, just trying to get a few more fans out there as well. So.
Okay, we're allotted the same amount to start each year. That hasn't changed. And our seasonal gate last year was $40,479. This year, not including our spring, was $23,539.
I think one thing's important to note. When you get to the state playoffs, especially in football, all gate receipts go to MPSSAA. Yep. So if you're playing Queen Anne's and Kent Island back again and you have 8,000 people showing up, see you.
We don't get to see
the MPSSAA. So.
So, for this next fiscal year, I requested a little over $111,000. The breakdown, some of the larger breakdowns are there. Really, our main expenses are our officials, and then uniforms and team equipment, which I don't think is too surprising there.
Our budget request was $109,000. Again, game officials is our biggest expense when we host a tournament or whatnot, and as well as our equipment and uniforms. And this year we purchased quite a few uniforms, so that's why it's a little lower as it rotates every few years.
So this year we've added the position of a full-time athletic trainer at both high schools, and we've really seen that just be a tremendous benefit. I was talking to a few coaches today as well. Not only the concussion baseline testing, but really the treatment during the week treatment that our athletes are able to receive that either is, we believe, preventing injuries or at least getting them back on the field. Or if nothing else, really a couple of the teachers said they believe our athletes are better focused in the classroom due to not, you know, suffering an injury or having a long-standing injury. That's where certainly the game coverage is important from a liability standpoint, but really the day-to-day interaction our trainers are having with our student athletes is where we're seeing the biggest impact. And I think the numbers there as far as number of athletes being seen is significant. So really, one of the main reasons we wanted to come here was to be able to share our successes, talk about the financial burden that athletics puts on the county. We think the benefits offset the cost. And so we just wanted to be able to present that as well. So thank you for your time.
Yeah.
Any questions?
I actually had a question. No, it's a legit question.
Okay.
So you guys are talking about the mind over motion, the awards, and so the minimum is a 3.25 GPA. Do you guys by any chance have like the average GPA of like all the athletes together?
We used to do it by team, but some teams are a little smaller than others, so you can almost identify a student, so we don't do that as well, as much as we did in the past. But I know Power School, we do have that set up as teams identifying, so it wouldn't be something too hard.
I have the overall for the winter, just because we presented it. It was a 3.48. So again, 3.25 was that's the minimum standard set by the state to give you that recognition. Our athletes right now are at a 3.48. So
I want to say that Minds in Motion, they pick one male and one female winner from each district out of the eight districts in the state of Maryland, and we represent the entire Bayside Conference, and two out of the past 3 years, there's been a student from Queen Anne's County High School receive that award, and which is quite an honor because you look at all their credentials of athletics, academics, community support, and then they get to go to Raven Stadium to have basically a luncheon in the locker room of the stadium, and it's quite a neat experience. So I think we're pretty successful. I also want to say thank you for the athletic trainers. It's been a great asset to us. It really has, with the concussion baseline training testing. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We don't need to take a break, do we?
Presentation.
That's it.
Keep on moving.
Yep.
At this time, we'll move to the individual action items.
So we have 8.01, which will be the HR report. Mr. Farley?
Yes, I would ask the board to approve the HR report as provided.
I make a motion that we approve the HR report as presented in closed session.
I second the motion.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to accept the HR report as presented in closed session. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed say no. The ayes have it.
So 8.02, which will be the transportation contract extension, and this is asking a recommendation to the board for an extension of our current contract with our transportation providers.
That's correct. We're looking for a one-year extension to have a total of 3 years for a contract.
So we need a motion to accept the transportation report and contract extension as presented by Mr. Sid Pender.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to accept the transportation report and contract extension. Is that right? Yes.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Presented by Mr. Sid Pender. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it.
Great, so 8.03, we have 8.03 to 8.06. Well, the first two will be in the recommendation of the calendar. So Mr. Farley as well as Mr. Brown, As you know, we wanted to come back to the board depending on how our snow days were going to fall and make a recommendation to you for our last day of school, and that's what they're going to do. And also, and then we'll roll right into the next 8.04, which will be next year's calendar. As they're doing that, I would like to recognize Karen Fields, our union president, for her leadership. As you know, Karen and I meet once a month. We meet together. We also meet on other issues, and it has been a great partnership. And I will say some of the recommendations that you're going to see this evening have been in joint collaboration with our teachers union. Directly, some of their suggestions are going to be very visible in some of the recommendations, especially at the end of the year. And as Ms. Anthony, I want to recognize her as well for coming forward, that you'll see in that joint collaboration. One of the things that Karen had recommended is we were getting feedback from our elementary teachers was to have an elementary focus group, which we did, that met with Mr. Brown and met with Mr. Farley and made some recommendations that they were able to work into this recommendation of the calendar. So I appreciate Karen's leadership, and as we work together to make a recommendation for having a very early potential close the school year.
Potential? No more snow. Snow's over with.
Spender?
So do you have the document? Do you have the
no
documents?
More snow.
That's not perfect. Do you have the 2016-17 school calendar?
We have them on.
Okay, and so we aren't doing too well in the technology department here this evening, so let me just share with you, if I may. And Dave, please help me out if I'm going off track. As Mr. Paluski said, we can't thank everybody who puts into this process of calendar development, because we all benefit from fresh minds. And certainly this year, the elementary teachers gave us a lot of great ideas. Mr. Brown's been doing this a long time. Others who know their way around a very complicated process. So we thank you all for your patience and for your ideas and your support. This year we have before you this evening a request to approve the final modifications to the 16-17 calendar. Obviously we didn't need some of our snow days, so we were able to wrap up school on 6-9, and one of the suggestions made by the teachers was to make the last days of our school year 6-7 through 6-9 half days.
Can you scroll that up a little bit just to show the end of the school year? Perfect.
Thank you, Dave. So you'll see that there, between this year and next year, there's a lot more use of half days in order to meet testing, professional development, et cetera, needs.
I have a question on that. How many snow days? I thought we had 3 snow days.
No, we had 2.
We only had 2?
2. We have 5 built in, and we had right. 2 in yeah. January.
Oh, that worked out then, because I was thinking 3, and it was hard to get them back on a Monday. Thanks.
So that's the 16-17 calendar. Dave, did you have anything you wanted to say about 16-17?
Not unless there's questions. About
any questions about the current year? Okay.
And we'd like to then make a recommendation
yes.
to accept or adopt the revisions to the 16-17 academic calendar.
I make a motion that we accept the 16-17 revised calendar.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to accept the 2016-2017 calendar.
Aye.
Revision.
Oh, revisions. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it.
We great. Thank you.
And then we will begin our mass communication tomorrow or this evening, letting everybody know last day for students and teachers will be on the 9th.
And that the last 3 days will be half days, so
yes.
people can plan
correct.
Appropriately.
So move on to 8.04. This is some calendar recommendations, revisions for FY 17 and 18.
So at
At this time, thought you were putting your hand up, Paige. I thought you were putting your hand up. At this time, we're also asking for approval to revise the 17-18 calendar to correct for an unnecessary PD day for middle schools in January of 2018, and to add the suggestions of the elementary group and the calendar committee to do three things: to change the spring conference day to half days, and to have these conferences on an as-needed basis rather than for all students. So the primary focus will be on the fall conferences and as needed for spring conferences.
This for every grade or
elementary, middle?
Elementary, middle.
So they want to cut back the conference time? All we've been hearing all year is how much more conference time we need.
I think the superintendent has provided some latitude in helping people understand that they could have telephone conversations with those people who wanted that kind of contact in lieu of face-to-face. And it was challenging for everyone to get in on a face-to-face basis twice a year.
I know, but you said you just cut it to half days, and that doesn't make sense to me because we got a lot of complaints about from parents not getting their elementary conference. And the elementary, unless I just didn't get this, but the elementary teachers were upset they didn't have enough time to devote to it, and this
but they're the ones that sort of recommended the
yes.
spring as needed. The teachers did.
Fall is
fall, pretty much straight across the board. We had a recent email indicating that they really were recommending.
Who recommended it?
The teachers.
Would you like to hear
the same
from
elementary teachers that were complaining we didn't have enough time?
They didn't have enough time to meet with every parent.
Yes, yeah. I'm just curious. This doesn't make sense
to meet with
please.
Every parent
so
as a mandatory.
I was one of the people that worked on trying to come up with a solution. I think that when teachers are, when teachers are complaining about not having enough time, I think it's because we are expected to have 100% representation. That's always been unofficially what we're expected to have. We want all the parents to come in and conference with us. So by lessening that expectation in the spring, we can meet with, the complaints are coming because teachers are under the impression that they have to meet with everybody. Does that make sense? So by saying that the spring
face.
Is only, right, face-to-face.
Face-to-face.
We phone conference all the time with parents. We email parents. We do that all the time on a regular basis. But we felt that by trying, because again, our agenda was to try to get those PD days back in January. We can't get the PD days back if we don't find another day somewhere in the calendar to put that day back in. So we feel that in the spring, our parents, for example, we're getting ready to conference now, and we just gave our trimester to progress report. So we really have already presented parents with information about how their child is currently doing, and now we're meeting with them a week and a half later. We felt that the spring conferences were more suited for an as-need basis, where the fall, before we give a progress report to the parents, it would be nice to meet with them face-to-face, talk about some struggles, give some suggestions, and try to get kids in the right direction before we give them their first progress report.
In the fall, you're talking about?
In the fall.
Which you have been doing it more frequently than just fall. My worry is not about the teachers, it's the parents. And there is an expectation of parents of elementary kids that they're going to see their teacher and talk about. I know when I was an elementary parent. Maybe we need to have a great marketing program to be sure that we don't get a zillion emails from parents that say, why aren't we having my conference?
Well, I think a lot of it is exactly as she explained, that they are at the elementary level really in contact with their teachers on a pretty regular basis. And I'm imagining, my standpoint as a parent, if I saw there was a problem, I would have already called you. I would have already marched in there.
I would hope that you would have been in contact with you before.
Yeah, I totally agree with all of that. I'm just saying there is an expectation of elementary parents that they're going to be seen. But
I'm thinking the word optional is for the parent, not the teacher. If a parent wants a conference,
yeah,
they
absolutely
will have it with the
yeah
teacher. It's yeah optional for the parent, not optional for the teacher.
Okay. My point is we just need to market this well before next year, when the year starts, to let them know. Maybe at meet and greet, make sure that's understood.
It is definitely a change of philosophy.
It's a change.
And one of the benefits of having a multi-year calendar approach is that we can begin communicating these things when we're pretty far out, so parents can plan. And that is something we plan to do.
Because I believe children's parents really can ask for a conference anytime.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
So.
Yeah, I know that.
And they do, especially at the elementary level.
And I also think that a lot of times at conference time, I mean, I believe Kennard is having a 12-hour day to get their conferences in.
They are, yes.
That's a huge burden on the teachers and the parents who may have gone to work at 7 o'clock and aren't even going to get to their conference till 7 o'clock at night. I wouldn't be happy with that either. I think the flexibility of conversation and telephone conferences frees a lot of that anxiety up. It's not that they're not going to get it. They may not need it face-to-face. I know some parents who tell me they've never had a face-to-face with their teacher. They've done everything either by phone or by email because their work schedule or their commitment schedule, whatever it may be, caring for an elderly parent, does not warrant them the time to do that, but they've never been denied if they've asked for a meeting.
That's right, absolutely.
I think that's the key.
We would never deny a parent.
And like Jen said, not that it's optional for the teachers. The teachers are going to meet all of their requests and all of their requirements.
And we still do, honestly, even with conferences being allotted on those days. I know, for example, our conferences this year align with our spring break. So there are seven half-hour conferences I'm conducting during planning, before school, after school, because those parents are on vacation.
On top of your 12-day.
Exactly, on top of working from 7:30 to 7:30 on Tuesday. So that's just the nature of the beast, so.
Yeah.
So the other thing I want to add to this, if you look at our strategic, the indicators in our plan, in the communication one, it has where the parent conferences. And that's something I think that we have to take a look at as a school system as we're revising our indicators, because it really should be about engagement, whether we're engaging parents, we're engaging the community as a whole, rather than that particular indicator. That's one way in which we do that. So that ties into this as well, is that because that indicator is there, that's where that mindfulness is around it. But I think that one, changing and looking at that around overall engagement, and the fact that we've changed to more flexibility, that, you know, we count a phone conference, if that's the case, as a parent conference, that's okay to do that. Or if it's, you know, through a virtual, you're still getting communication contact with the parent. And that's what we want. I mean, as long as there's an open dialogue and open communication with our parents, we'll never turn a parent away to sit down and talk about the progress. There's nothing greater than to be able to do that.
Well, when I first read this, the email, I guess it was that I read it, and so I asked some parents of our elementary children, and what the feedback that I got was that the first one was always the most important one.
Absolutely.
And the second one was. A lot of them said that they didn't even go to it. They didn't even make an appointment to do it. And then I heard a lot say that I call it, or I send the teacher an email and she sends it to me. And then I spoke to teachers and they said the same thing. The first one seems like all the parents come out to do it. And then the second one, they even make appointments and parents don't show up to them.
Right.
So.
Well, and I think they've developed a relationship over the course of that year.
Exactly.
They feel a lot more comfortable talking on the phone or
exactly.
by email
and
or just running in at the end
of the
day.
And we have parents in all
the
time at the elementary
right.
level. I mean, just
right.
for various
right.
things.
Right.
So, you know, by the spring, I think a lot of them do feel
right.
they're comfortable.
More comfortable.
Exactly.
And I will say, back in the day when I raised my kids, which was a long time ago, and we won't talk about that, they were long. It was several days. It was still a long day for the teacher. We complained about that too, that it was way too much time to spend on conferences over the course of like 3 days, I believe it would be back in that time. And the children didn't go to school at all. There was a lot of conflict from that process too. So maybe it is time to start trying something new.
Right.
As long as, like Beverly, Captain Kelly says, we get it out there in the correct manner. There's not a lot of rumors about it and somebody saying something that really isn't pertaining to the way it's going to be. If we can have a clear, concise public statement about it, I think that would solve a lot of heartache in the future. but I think this might be good. I hate the fact that you teachers are having 12-hour days, though. I will say that.
It's a long day.
We have 12-hour days all the time. We just do it at home in our pajamas.
Well, I know you do it, but yeah, I know that. But just the stress, I think, of even scheduling all of those 24 conferences, I guess, in a 12-hour period.
I have a big
and getting it documented with the parent and getting everybody on that piece of paper, I would think was an overwhelming job. And I know that was difficult for you guys. So.
A couple other areas of the calendar. It is the post-Labor Day start, and we do finish on June 15th, so we are meeting the governor's mandates. We have 4 built-in snow days. We really need a 5th snow day just in case we have a bad winter next year. In order to request a waiver due to snow, you have to have 5 built-in snow days. So our 5th day, if we need it, is March 29th. And you'll notice a note there that if we've used 4 days by March 7th, we will be expected to be in school March 29th, which is the Thursday before Easter. And that's basically the only date we can reclaim at that point.
What can you do?
And that's scheduled so that the March board meeting, we would be able to adjust the calendar. By switching the PD days and the conference day, it did allow us to get all our schools on the same calendar. All PD days will be the same, all PD days will be the same for all schools. That will actually eliminate a couple of days of transportation for part of the school system and not other parts. So it will save money on transportation as well. And the other thing I'd like to say, we've got a group of teachers, some of which are here, that after the calendar was approved in December, brought up their concerns, and they did more than that. They came to a calendar committee meeting, rolled up their sleeves, and helped us come up with some really good ideas. I would just like to express my appreciation for all those teachers that helped us out and didn't just sit back and complain.
Absolutely.
Thank you, ladies. Thank you.
I'd also just like to share that our calendar for 17-18 ends the same way as this year ends, with the last 3 days being half days, 2 for the elementary and 3 for the high school. So between the flexibility we gained from making it sort of early spring decision on snow and the way we plan to wrap up the year in a way that benefits our teachers and students, we ask for your approval for this 17-18 revised calendar, and we will keep you informed and if we need to make adjustments, come before you as we have this time. May I ask that you please.
Okay. You may say so when you
can I have a motion to accept the 2017-2018 revised school calendar?
So moved.
No, I made the motion.
Oh,
can I
have? That's the second time I've done that. Second time.
All right.
Second.
I was.
It's the second time I've jumped in.
I will second it then if you moved it.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to accept the 2017-2018 revised calendar. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it.
Mr. Paluski, did you want to share with the board the plan to move to the 4-day work week or get that moving soon? Or
We can. I believe that the board is aware of that, but we'll be moving, as we've done in years past, to 4-day work week. I believe, don't quote me there, Mr. Farley, that will begin on June,
I want to say 9th.
23rd. June 23rd.
Right.
9th is the last day for teachers and students, but June 23rd, that week, And then we'll go until the middle of, I think, August. The 18th.
Yeah, it's a total August. Of 9 weeks.
So it'll be 9 weeks. So that will be a little bit of incentive for all of our 12-month folks that will be doing four-day work weeks. So, but for our curriculum folks, the expectation is they still got to get all 5 days done in four.
Thank you, board members.
Thank you.
Thank
Have a nice evening.
Thank you.
So we also did want to bring before you 8.05 is a recommendation for board meeting schedule for 17 and 18 dates.
I won't be here on the 19th of July.
I don't have a clue when I'll be here. Which one are you looking at?
The red one? The 17 and 18, which would be, if you click on board docs, it would be the one on the first. Okay. That date we can, normally there's not a work session in July, but if all the board members, we can take that off there and we can revise that and reschedule a retreat for the, a date that would be mutually agreed upon by the board. It wouldn't have to be, we can just advertise that as we've done.
Scary to say, these dates are subject to change anyhow. I mean, you know.
Sure, just like the work sessions. I know normally there's not a work session in August and in July, you know, due to obvious reasons of people. But I know we do put them on there in case it is needed.
Okay, we need to do it.
So we'll remove maybe we can put in parentheses board retreat. We can just put tentative.
Right. July 19th?
Yes. Miss Jackie, we'll just put that in tentative, and then when we get closer, we might have to make an adjustment to that.
So. You said the same with August 16th. Okay.
August 16th.
I'm looking at the whole calendar.
Vacation in anyhow.
Well, we could just remove it. Or you feel more comfortable to keep it on
summer,
there?
The summer.
Just leave it on.
We'll just leave it on there.
They already say tentative next to them anyway.
True.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Just leave.
Okay.
What is the board retreat? Is that the ESMEC?
The July 19th?
Or this
proposed? Is that the ESMEC down there?
No, that would be follow-up to the retreat in January.
Board meeting. Okay. Yes, that's
we'll
what
deal with them as we deal with them.
Okay.
Is the board okay with those proposed dates so we can begin our scheduling?
Sure.
Okay. Okay. Then I'll need a.
We don't need a motion or anything for those.
Do we need a motion?
No, I don't think so.
You don't need them? Okay. No. Wasn't sure if they officially had to be approved. Then 8.06, you have the 18-19, and the recommendation there is to continue to, so everybody's okay with, okay, very good. Then we'll begin the planning process. Great. Then we've got 8.07, which is our policies for the third read, and Mr. Farley, I don't believe that we have received any feedback. The only recommendation we would like to make to the board is that we table the American with Disabilities Act accommodation for employees in order to be to meet with compliance on web accessibility. So we need to gather more information on that and would like to come back with you to you with some revised language in that policy.
Yes, please.
I make a motion that we table the Americans with Disabilities Act accommodations and employment until we receive additional language that we need for the web accessibility.
I second the motion.
Mr. Paluski, I do have one comment on the social media policy, if I could bring that up to you so you can.
Just hold on, Mr. Policy, or Mr. Policy. Mr. Policy. Mr. Farley. That will be 9.01. So if you could just hold that for 1 second until we get to that action item.
There's a motion on the table and a second.
What was the, I know, But I need to know what you...
The motion was to table the Americans with Disabilities Act accommodations and employment until we receive additional language that will help with the web accessibility.
Compliance. Correct. Other than that, those seek an approval on the other three policies.
Let me see if I can get this right. I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call the vote to accept, or no,
to table
the American with Disabilities Act accommodations employment for additional language
web access.
For web access.
Ability. Accessible. Sorry.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it.
Thank you. Then we would make the recommendation to move the final policies, recruitment, selection of staff, leadership development, successive planning, and compensation forward is the third and final read for adoption.
We need a motion for that, don't we?
I make a motion that we move the policies, recruitment and selection of staff, leadership development and succession planning, and compensation out for the third and final read.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to accept the recruitment and selection of...
Not accept it. We're putting it out for a third and final
read. Oh, for a third. Okay. For third and final read. Recruitment and selection of staff, leadership development and succession planning, and compensation. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed say no. The ayes have it.
Excellent. Thank you. 8.08, our recommendation for the field trip for Stevensville Middle School to attend the North Bay Adventure Camp from May 1st to May 5th, 2017.
We just bundle this in one motion. We have a Mattapique Middle School to Tennessee, STEAM to Tennessee. Is that on yours?
That is
the field trips.
Yeah. I apologize. I do not have that in front of me.
Right. Is it supposed to be on there? Is that make sure it's not a mistake?
You can get another agenda.
So it's the correct.
It is correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I make a motion that we accept the field trips for. Or approve the field trips for Stevensville Middle School to North Bay Venture Camp May 1st to May 5th, 2017, and Mattapique Middle School STEAM to Tennessee.
I second the motion.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to accept the field trips for Stevensville Middle School to North Bay Venture Camp May 1st through the 5th, 2017, and Mattapique Middle School STEAM to Tennessee. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed say no. The ayes have it.
Great. Thank you.
The next is future action items.
So we have 9.01, which is our policy for its second read, which is employee use of social media. And I do believe Mr. Farley has one public comment.
Have you seen the comment already, Mr. Paluski?
No, sir.
May I bring it to you?
That's a good comment.
And I'll paraphrase.
Okay.
To paraphrase, the commenter is concerned with the lack of clarity on the requirement that you not post the photograph of a Queen Anne's County Public Schools student on your personal social media account without the permission of their parent, unless that person is a blood relative, etc. And the person comments that that would be very difficult to do in Queen Anne's County, given the close nature of the community. I don't know how to clarify that anymore. The requirement in the social media policy is for the purpose of protecting our students, and I think it's reasonable.
The only thing I was thinking after I read the comment, Mr. Farley, was, and I'll use my daughter as an example, we're on a sports team, and we're taking pictures of the team after they win, so to speak, and hopefully anyway. and you have a group picture, and my husband's a teacher, and so he puts on his Facebook page a picture of the team. Now, is he required to go and get every parent's approval before he puts that on there, or am I as a board member?
Well, these are questions
that's what I'm asking. Like, is that, I think that that was kind of, you know, that's, I think, you know, when we're speaking in those terms,
I agree.
I don't, would it be, you know, are we asking them not to put pictures up under the context of their students, or are we putting it up as like, hey, I can't take a picture of my neighborhood kid with my child because, I mean, so that's what I'm asking.
I don't think there's an easy answer. I think the truth is that for every photograph we put up on the Queen Anne's County Public Schools social media sites, we have a parent release for every single
photo. But you're acting on a part of the school. So as a teacher outside of school at a field, I'm using a field because it's just sports. I'm sports minded right now.
Right, yeah. That's the language.
Could we add language saying, if you're adding it as under the umbrella as I'm an employee of elementary or of the school system, I need permission. But as if I'm adding a picture under my personal page because I'm a parent and I'm on a team or my neighborhood kids are playing and doing something fun that we took a picture of, I mean, is that, I think we need to clarify what the, maybe the definition of the how you're presenting yourself on Facebook. If it's under, you know, my if I'm a teacher, my teacher's Facebook page, then that's different. But if it's, that's what I'm asking, or.
I'd like to give that some thought.
Okay.
So you're saying if you're presenting yourself as an employee of the Queen Anne's County.
Of course you would have to do that.
Anyway.
So we will take a look at it, and we'll certainly consult with counsel on this as well, as I'm sure we're not the only school system that's dealing with such an issue.
I think you need to consider it, because once you're an employee, you're always an employee. So, you know, who looks at your page, they're looking at you. Some may look at you because you're, I mean, that's the way it is in the military. You got to be really careful about that. Once you're in it, you're always in it.
That's a good point.
But there's no easy answer, like you said. So we need to really
think through it a little bit more. I shared it with a friend because her daughter was in it. Yeah. But there were other kids in the background, too. It was a jump rope for her heart at the gym, you know?
Right.
It's kind of like, wow, I never would have even thought at a personal level.
No, it isn't.
At a professional level, sure. Because actually, I think a teacher took it and said she had permission to take all those kids' pictures. But I wouldn't have known that, sharing my grandson's picture.
Right, right, exactly.
Mm. But we need to be sensitive.
So this is a great discussion. We will...
that's a tough one.
We'll take that under advisement. We'll work on that. We'll consult with Mr. Burns on that and bring you back a recommendation.
Maybe whoever wrote that is going to be watching QACTV and will hear our discussion, and maybe we'll send in another comment as to what they mean and give us a leeway.
Sure.
Give us give us some direction as to how we do that, how we do this.
But this is why we certainly appreciate that feedback.
That's
so
right,
we'll take a look at it. We'll bounce it from a lot of different angles and seek counsel and come back with a recommendation of some revised language.
It's why we post drafts and ask for feedback.
Right.
Perfect.
Right. Great idea. Okay, so I need a motion to send out the employee use of social media policy for the second read.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
I thought we were going to table it, though. Or you just?
No, we were tabling the Americans. It's just going out for the second read, so we still have another.
Right.
That way people can put more information on it, too. So I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to send out the employee use of social media policy for the second read. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it.
9.02, recommendation from Ms. Pauls and our curriculum instruction staff for our science fundamentals of physics to go for a review.
Yes. And I'm sorry, could our high school kids leave there? They have homework to do?
Sure.
I asked her if she wanted to. I already asked her if they wanted to. She said they were fine. But it's up to you guys.
We have short time, so
I just recommend it.
Thank you.
Sure, go ahead, ladies. I'll always ask. It's your option.
Thank you.
Yeah. You don't have to.
Do we need a recommend, do we have to need a motion to accept the textbook?
Yes, for its recommendation for, to put out public to review.
Textbook, and we have a copy here for anyone who would love to read this at leisure.
Sure.
And we will have a copy out front for parents or anyone from the community who would like to take a look at it. But it's approved by College Board as accurate and acceptable, so it's definitely an update for our high school students.
So I need a motion to accept the textbook science fundamental of physics.
Are we making a motion to accept it or just to put it out for review?
We have to put it out for review as part of our policy. It'll be out for, I believe, 30 days, and we'll bring it back to you at the May for then its adoption. If we get feedback, we would bring that to you if there was any public comment on it. So it is just to go into review for 30 days for the public to review.
I need a motion for the textbook science fundamental of physics to go out for review.
So moved.
Second. I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to send out for review the textbook science fundamental of physics. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it. Now, next two air reports. Mr. Paluski, you're first up.
Yes. Two very brief things. On March 2nd, Ms. Pauls and I, numerous members from Queen Anne's County Public Schools, attended the third conversation on race at Chesapeake Community College. This event was more directed towards service, so it was in great partnership with our law enforcement. And I will tell you, each time I attend one of these, you learn so much more. But the best part about this event is that we had students from both Queen Anne's County High School and Kent Island High School attend. And I will tell you how riveting it was to listen to them. They had the most powerful voice in the room. The next one, which will be Sunday, April 23rd, which is now going to be in the north. The first one in the north will be at Crumpton Fire Hall, which I believe will be our fifth conversation on race Sunday supper. I did not put it on my report, but I do want to brag that today, Ms. Pauls and I, Mr. Farley, numerous staff members, we held our second Bowie State University recruitment fair at Stevensville Middle School today. It was outstanding. We had our largest number, nearly 50 participants, Ms. Pauls, in the 40s. It was a great day. And I really want to give kudos to Mr. Engel. This was really his concept. We get a bus every year now. We go to Bowie State, and Mr. Engel is the first to greet them on campus, welcomes them, talks about Queen Anne's County Public Schools, and is the first really ambassador that they meet. And then once they get dropped off, we have a little overview session, and then they meet with principals, they do overviews, and then they went on two tours today of Stevensville, as well as Kent Island Elementary School and Bayside. So appreciate, you know, Brad's support of that, Mr. Farley, our school administrators that were there. A great day to showcase Queen Anne's County Public Schools.
Were any of those locals? Did we have any locals there?
We did
As
not.
As locals, you know, that are attending Bowie State.
I think it's one of the next things is to add maybe a couple more universities. But one of the most powerful speakers today that we had was Mr. Jones. He is a first-year teacher at Bayside Elementary School, and last year sat in their seat, and we recruited him from BOE, and he spoke to them from his perspective and how much he just absolutely adored Queen Anne's and said, you know, this is a place for you too, and come and join our family and be a part of it. So it was a great day. It was a great day. So that wasn't on my list, but I wanted to showcase that because there's a lot of people that put a lot of things into place that day. And it's very difficult to follow Ms. Paul's speaking. So, but I did try.
Was that a compliment, Ms. Paul?
I think that's a big, we've been doing that for a few years, but that's the largest number we ever had.
It is. It's been our second year. So yeah, first year, and anytime you do it in the first year. But we had almost 20 students our first year, but this year it grew. And Dr. Long, who is the professor there, that we've developed a great partnership, that really Brad has fostered that partnership. She just speaks volumes about this experience. And when you talk to the students, we're the only public school system that has made an effort to go and get them and bring them to us to show them how much we value them and we want them a part of our community. So
that's great.
Many of them wanted to sign up and, you know, are looking for housing and so.
So these are 4-year students. They're
just getting ready to graduate. Either they're graduating in a few weeks or they're going to graduate in December. They're right on that, either getting ready to graduate in their first career opportunity or soon within the next 7 or 8 months. So, it was great for the entire staff. A lot of people putting their time involved in it. So.
Good. As we were sitting here, I had an email from one of them who was ready to sign on, saying she felt the sense of family and that this was a place where she wanted to be.
So that's great. Absolutely. Yay. Well, so we go right into you to curriculum and instruction report.
Yes, ma'am. So we supervisors have really been busy attending state briefings, county meetings, doing observations, learning walks, writing curriculum policies, and they've been updating their job descriptions. So they have been very busy and doing a great job. As one of our business ed meetings, we did tour NRL at the Business Park on Kent Island, and they are ready to offer some jobs to some of our folks, some of our students. We had a great tour, great business relationship that we will be able to foster with that company. Excuse me. I don't know why you all get me choked up tonight.
Sorry. Here for you.
Moving my seat. This weekend, I had the opportunity to attend a lot of events at schools. Attended the All Shore Band concert at the high school. I attended Sutlersville Middle School's Junior National Honor Society First Lady Art Show basketball game at Sutlersville Middle School, Bayside Elementary School, and Kent Island Elementary School. And I'd just like to give kudos to our staff members and our principals who will go above and beyond and really give a lot of their time. These events were on Friday night, Saturday, and Sunday. And when it was a beautiful day, you really could be out enjoying the day. They were there to support the students and staff in their school. So it was very hilarious in some of the activities. But our students did a great job, and kudos to our teachers and our principals. So. Move my seat, please.
Okay. Then we're Ms. Robbins and the expenditure report.
Okay, you have in front of you the expenditure report. There's really not too many areas at this point in time that we have a concern about. There is a letter there that's attached to it asking to transfer funds within category to cover some of the things that we have discussed in the last couple board meetings where we had some overages. So in administration, instruction, special education, and operations, we're asking to move some funds. So I would like approval to be able to send this letter to the county commissioners to inform them that we do not need to seek their approval because this is an in-category transfer. We just need approval to send them the letter.
I make a motion that we send the letter over to the commissioners for the funds transfer.
I second the motion.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to accept the expenditure report.
Yeah, send a letter over to
To send a letter over to the county commissioners, correct?
Yes.
Okay. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, say no. The ayes have it.
The only other thing on the expenditure report is we're drawing towards the end of the year. We're watching some expenditures very closely. At this point in time, the only area in the budget that I have any concern about may be transportation. We'll just have to see how some of the end of the year numbers work out. We're down 4 drivers at this point in time, so we were having some extended overtime happening with some of our drivers. So we'll keep an eye on that, and if we need to do an out-of-county transfer or out-of-category transfer into that, luckily we've had a very mild winter, and Mr. Pender's giving me back some money in heating costs. So
I like the out-of-county transfer money to us. I like that. Take that.
Out-of-category transfer. And that's all I have. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to entertain them.
I also say I forgot in my report that we did have state superintendent to visit Queen Anne's County Public Schools last Friday. Mr. Kaluski and the principals gave her a tour of 4 buildings, and she seemed to be extremely pleased with what she observed. So I appreciate her visit.
Thank you.
Yes. Yeah. Fine, now I have a motion and for the expenditure report, correct? Or no? We don't need it because the only thing we needed was that. Okay. Do we have any citizens that want to participate and talk again? Where'd all of our citizens go? All right, so I need a motion to adjourn the meeting.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion to adjourn the
We're going to do the upcoming meetings and events.
Oh, I did. I'm sorry. I forgot that. Upcoming meetings and events.
So as you know, we have a variety of events coming up beyond our normal work session or board meetings, but the District 5 solo and ensemble recognition, I just want to point out, this is going to be the first time that we've recognized our band students in this magnitude, and that will be at Queen Anne's County High School on the 8th, and I hope that all of you will have the opportunity to attend that event. And then certainly the art gallery, which is a traditional event here on May 17th. So I hope that you'll all be able to attend. And then, hard to believe, but June 19th will be here before we know it, and that will be the Eastern Shore Summer Education Conference that we normally, hopefully, all will be able to attend as a board.
Is that the one that's at Chesapeake College?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so... we already had a motion to
adjourn the meeting.
Yeah. A second.
Okay.
I have a motion to adjourn the open session meeting. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, say no. The ayes have it.
There you go. See you on the 19th.